Hello everybody and welcome back at our event, guiding cancer treatment in the 21st century. Sorry for that. In the first part of our event, we have seen new developments in diagnostics and how we can implement them in the clinical care. And now we will continue with some examples of technology which is already in place. We have also seen in the first part there is a huge increase in cancer treatments. With immune therapy, there is really a new treatment option for cancer patients. What we also know is that there is a lot of discussion in the press, especially in the Dutch press, about affordability and accessibility of cancer medicines, but also other medicines. And I think that this discussion will only increase with the upcoming cell and gene therapies. And I experienced the debates in the Dutch public space as quite polarized. And I also think that it does not really address the real problems. And sometimes it does not really recognize the improvements which are made and how we really benefit patients. If you look at drug development, then we have to conclude that drug development takes a long time. It's expensive and the risks of failures are still very high. So if you dive deeper in this process, then you also see that the cost of drug development are mainly driven by the cost of capital and otherwise by the cost of failure. So if you would like to change something here, you have to lower the cost of capital and cost of failure by decreasing the risk and also working faster. And that's why we at Holland Bio have the program Faster Better from Bed to Bedside. From bench to bedside, sorry for that. And within this program, we have different action lines. We have an action line, for example, about patient centricity. We think that when you develop a new therapy, you have to put the patient perspective first. That does not mean that I think that the patient should be the CEO of a company or should be the researcher in the lab. But I think that everybody should understand what the needs are for patients and what their challenges are. Second line, and we also discussed that very briefly in the first part of this meeting, is about the adaptive ecosystem. If we start developing more complex trials and more innovative trial designs with smaller patient groups, which is the future if you look at the development in personalized medicine, we also need an adaptive system for the reimbursement. We need a learning system, one of the speakers called it, and I think that's a good description. And another part where we focus on at Holland Bio is the part we are going to discuss this afternoon. We call it smarter testing. We see more and more companies who develop very smart technologies that can help us, that can help in the stratification of patients, or these technologies can help to in the phase of drug development to decrease the risk. And I also think that it's difficult to get these new technologies really implemented. Sometimes we are just used to do it in a certain way. Sometimes new technologies are not adapted in the clinical reality. So here is also a lot of work to do. And it's also something where we do not have a simple solution for. It's not a matter of switching only one thing and then it's solved. So that's why in the second part of this meeting, we really would like to pay more attention about the new technologies developed and how they can be implemented in the real world. So because that's the proof of the pudding is in the eating. So our first speaker is from a company which has been around in the Netherlands for quite long. It's called Agendia. They were real pioneers in developing diagnostic ways to identify patients in breast cancer. So I'm very happy that Caroline joins us today. Caroline van der Meijden, she holds a PhD and has been active in several pharmaceutical companies. So she brings a lot of experience today. So Caroline, please go ahead.
Thank you. So yes, my name is Caroline van der Meijden. I have experience in pharmaceutical companies. I also have experience in science way back. My PhD was actually with a microarray analysis. And what I was really impressed with when I was doing my PhD was the science. It was the beginning of 2000. The first genome was sequenced in 2004. I was just talking to one of the other speakers that Jim Watson, who identified co-identified the DNA, was working around there. There was Dr. Slamon, who invented trastuzumab against HER2 cancer cells, gave a presentation. And one of the presentations that really stood out for me was a presentation by the founder, one of the founders of Agendia, and that was René Bernard. Because at that time, which was in the early 2000s, he presented, when we just knew about the genome, he presented that actually with this genome, we could identify which patients really benefit from therapy and for which patients the toxicities don't really weigh up against the small benefit to no benefit. And it really blew me away. In the meantime, I've also have some experience at the Dutch Healthcare Institute. So I can also elaborate a little bit on that. And in this talk, I would actually like to go to three pictures. Before I go there, let's take one moment to mind and act, to think and to do. It's actually the name of the pivotal trial from Agendia, and more results are coming up. But it's also something we should do with personalized medicine. So the pictures I would like to go through are the Wheels of Progress, the Tower of Babel, and a moving goalpost, or a level playing field. And we get to the questions on this later. I worked at Zinn, and when I was working at the Healthcare Institute, what was really profound to me is that there's a huge increase in costs for medicine. And you see here, it increased from 30 billion to 90 billion. So there's a real need to be careful with what you spend it on. And one of the ways to keep check on what you spend it on is appropriate care. So the right treatment for the right patient at the right time. It makes a lot of sense. At the same time, I was challenged in my current company that actually this line was too steep. So when you combine it with the expenditure, with the GDP, it becomes much flatter. It only increases 2% in the last 20 years. So there's still a need to be careful, but also, wow, we really increased with GDP. It's really doing phenomenal in the Netherlands. And maybe the reason that it's doing phenomenal is that we have great science and great companies. So one of the companies started in science and in academia, and it was in the NKI. I don't know if a lot of you know about the story, but basically the question was, can you identify which patients will benefit from therapies and which have such a good prognosis that you can leave therapies out. So based on the biopsies from these patients, the expression profiles were analyzed, and 70 genes that were markedly different between patients that had low risk of distant metastasis and high risk of distant metastasis were identified, making a fingerprint kind of what is the prognosis? And we had some control genes in the algorithm. And why this is, while this was developed, they didn't have a clue yet of what all these genes did. And it turned out that all these genes were involved in the pathway of metastasis, so distant recurrences. So even before you could clinically detect which patients would have metastasized disease and which would not, thanks to this technology, you could predict and really see which patients actually really needed therapy. Because as soon as you get to the latter stage of distant metastasis, the survival of these patients is only 10 to 30%. Well, if you are in the earlier stages, you can still treat these patients well. So criteria that are often used in a clinical pathological setting are the tumor size, the number of lymph nodes that are affected, and the grade of the tumor. So Holland Bio asked me to also clearly elaborate on what is needed to go from a bench product to a product that goes to patients. There's actually a lot of steps needed, and here you see a little bit of an overview for that. What you basically need to be is like a 3-star restaurants. Because the quality you deliver has to be of the same high standard every time. And so you have to ensure that the analysis you do is valid, that it stays valid even if you try different test different patients. And you have to get certification, certain quality marks, like the CE mark, like the ISO 13485, or an FDA mark. But next to that, there's also payers that will have to pay for your test. So we have one of three poll questions. The first one here is, if you consider wheels of progress, if all patients are tested with this test, would the test help the patient? Would the test help the payer, or would it help both? It looks like it's 50-50. Yeah, so in our opinion, it would help both, because if you would help the patient make the right decision for them and the physician together, you can actually save money on the treatment. You could actually prevent side effects, and it would better everybody. So it looks like we all agree here. And that brings us to the next step. So we have the clinical analytical validity, we have the clinical validation, and then we get to clinical utility. In order to show that you really have a benefit, you can do studies, and there's a level of evidence considered 1A if you have a prospective study with the test, and 1B if you use two retrospective specimens where you just use the biopsies and the outcome to determine the effectiveness. So the next poll question is, what is clinical utility? Is the poll going on or not? Is it use of the test in clinical practice? Is it adherence to the outcome of the test results, or the use of a biomarker that produces better outcomes for the patients than when it was not available? And now we see people voting in all three brackets, and you're all white. The clinical utility is a term that's used in a lot of different ways, depending upon who you talk to. So it can be used just how much do you use it in clinical practice. It can actually mean, does the physician adhere to the test results? In the case of MammaPrint, 90% of the physicians did prescribe MammaPrint, follow the outcome of MammaPrint. But for payers, like in the UK, they often want to really see different outcome than when the product wouldn't be there. So a different outcome can be survival, it can be quality of life. And then in normal escalation studies, you would compare these outcomes to the extra costs and maybe the side effects and maybe the productivity. But here we're talking about personalized medicine, and it's a little bit more complicated in the sense that it's quite new. So if you would consider a group of patients, and here you see on the left a group of patients that are colored gray and green. Let's say that these green patients, based on clinical factors, would already be decided that they would have a good prognosis and there's no need for extra therapy. So there's no medical needs. But what about the gray ones? So a test like MammaPrint could identify on a molecular level for which patients there's a higher risk of metastasized disease and have a higher need for treatment. Well, the green patients would actually potentially benefit better by not having the treatment, but of course that's still a decision up to the patient and the physician. If you look at those gray patients in a bar, in the left hand you see the clinical risk And according to clinical risk, you would consider all positive lymph nodes as a high clinical risk, so a high risk of metastatic disease. Well, if you look on a genomic level, half of these that would be considered high clinical risk would actually be a low genomic risk, so there would be less need for treatment. And looking at these gray patients once more, like what does this really mean? One of the things we're looking at is how do you translate the findings you find in clinical trials to a more lay audience? If you would treat these patients and they would get surgery, they would get radiotherapy, a lot of them would get hormonal therapy. There is a benefit from chemotherapy for these high clinical risk patients, but you could stratify these patients, and by stratification, you would identify those patients that benefit a lot, and it could actually help these patients because maybe they didn't want to take extra therapy and now they're more convinced to do it. And there's patients that are less benefited. Maybe 1 out of 100 would really benefit from this chemotherapy, or maybe none. Well, if you treat all of them with a therapy, nearly all of them will, depending upon the therapy, of course, some therapies are really great and others have more toxicity. But there was a study that showed that 99% of patients treated with chemotherapy and hormonal therapy would experience side effects. Some of those would be severe. So then this is a de-escalation study. So by you look in a different way, and this is quite a new way. Here you see that if there's not a really big clinical relevant difference, well, there's a lot of side effects, you have savings, you have a better quality of life and more productivity, it seems quite obvious that you would pay for this product. So what happened? If you look at the history of MammaPrint, it was discovered in 2002. In 2004, it was marketed. In 2007, there was FDA approval, so it was reimbursed in America. There was a Rosters trial that actually showed that second definition of clinical utility. So there is adherence to the test results. There is a MINDACT trial that was sponsored by the European organization, and it was completely set up by physicians. That also met its primary endpoint and showed there's a really good prognosis for these patients and less of a medical need. And we have had reimbursements in America in several countries. We now recently got reimbursed in Germany. In the Netherlands, the healthcare insurers have been very supportive. And we hope that the new data from MINDACT will actually also convince the healthcare institutes with their last doubts. So in Germany, we had a reimbursement on a specific group based on a specific study. And this is the last poll. If you do 2 retrospective RCTs, what kind of tests would be reimbursed by the US? Is it working, the poll? Yeah, so we see, again, votes for everything. Actually, the correct answer here is a prognostic test. So in the US, there's a whole system already laid out to receive reimbursement, and it's really nice that they've developed this. The difference between a prognostic test and a predictive test is just that a prognostic test indicates who can be spared a future treatment with potential toxicities, and predictive is who really has a benefit from a treatment. If you look at graphs, and I don't know if you can see these really well, survival graphs, on the bottom you see a predictive effect where there's a huge effect from the treatment, and in the top you see a prognostic effect where there's a 10% on the right hand mortality and a 20 to 50% on the left hand. So if you have differences in mortality rates, but you have a similar effectiveness, a similar hazard ratio, like here it's a hazard ratio of 7.7, a 30% reduction, it really has an effect on the absolute reduction from chemotherapy. So only a 10% mortality rate will yield a 2% effectiveness of chemotherapy that then doesn't weigh up against the side on the toxicity of chemotherapy. Well, a bigger, a worse prognosis, there will be a higher effectiveness. So it would be good if we could use similar international criteria. And if I want to give you, because there's new techniques coming up, there's also next generation sequencing, artificial intelligence, and actually optimization of treatments. Agenia didn't really stay with just microarrays. And if there's one thing I would like you to know from this talk is that personalized medicine really helps everybody. And let's not reinvent the wheel, but talk to each other. What are the nomenclatures and needs, and create a playing field for all of an international playing field, so that companies know where to go aim for. Because in the end, personalized care is appropriate care. The future is now, and it helps with the right treatment for the right patient at the right time. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Caroline, to take us to the whole journey of Agenia in the last few years. You already indicated that international standards would be helpful. And what do you think is the way to go there?
So there seems to be a whole new field here. This is all quite new for me too. I've been in different fields myself. And there seems to be a development here of how to look at these tests, of how to look at these biomarkers. And it would be good if companies know ahead of time, before you start your studies, to know what the goal is. And so if you have two retrospective studies and you get reimbursement on prospective, on a prognostic test, if you have identified beforehand what the cutoff criteria are, I think it would be great for science. And I mean, there are great scientists here, and it is a great company. So it shouldn't just happen only in America. It should happen here in Europe.
Yes, I agree that it's a little bit, but that's my personal opinion, it's a little bit disappointing that a Dutch innovation is not reimbursed in the Netherlands. And because I really think if you look at the talks, that the presentations we saw earlier today, that the Netherlands could be this front runner, but yes. At the moment we are obviously not. And is there any best practice we can borrow, or because I agree that we have to solve this on an international level to, but that's also that we know that will take a lot of time. So if you could change only one thing, one takeaway from the United States or any other country, what could we do in the Netherlands?
Yeah, so take the FDA guidelines, what they use for reimbursement, and evaluate whether we can use the same thing. And I think we should, and we could. And it will help our system save money, get better care for patients, and help innovation in the end.
I have one other question from the public. I will read it for you. With today's knowledge, would you or Agenia do something differently to bring your test to the clinic? And if yes, what? What can we learn from you? It's actually the question.
I think, I wasn't with Agenia in the beginning. I was just amazed with the science. I think they did an amazing job, the people from Agenia. I mean, Lara at Veer gets one award after the other. She's really a front runner. If anything, maybe we should talk earlier with, but they did already. So I don't know what happened there exactly. There's different views, and I have the highest respect of people from the healthcare institute. They only do their best. They're very smart. They're very dedicated. But it would be good if there was a bit more communication, maybe. But I wasn't there, so I don't know.
Yeah, I wasn't there either, so I don't know also.
And then at the same time, it took 20 years before a safety belt from invention was implemented in cars, before it was a law. And I kind of think Agenia was just a front runner and they're inventing the wheel. But I think the wheel is now invented and we should just start using it.
20 years, really?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that also. So in that perspective, we stay optimistic and I hope it will be soon reimbursed in the Netherlands. And not only the product of Agendia, but all the other diagnostic tools that can help for better stratification of patients and better outcomes. So thanks again, Caroline.
Thank you.
So we will move on to our next speaker. And our next speaker is Jos Jore. And Jos has been around in the biotech scene for almost 20 years. And he has had various positions on different biotech companies. And before he founded Mimetas together with his business partner. And I think Mimetas has been growing very, very rapidly. And they are focusing on 3D human disease models. And this is a fast growing market and an important driver for innovative drug development for the next century. So Jos, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Great to be here. Thanks for the invitation. And I'd love to share a story about Mimetas. Mimetas is all about creating human tissue models in order to develop better drugs and apply them in a better way. So this is a talk about phenotypic tumor modeling, analysis and screening due to the tumor and oncology context of this specific meeting. So this is where we come from. Before around the 1985, drug development was about having a compound. Having a compound that does something and turn it into something that could actually be used as a therapy. In about 85, people started to turn it into a different game. Identify a target and find compounds that could inhibit the target under the assumption that inhibiting the target actually would cure the patient. That's true in many cases, which led to development of many very, very efficacious and good drugs. But over time, the efficacy of that process went down. More and more drugs started to fail as soon as they were tested in people. And actually, that led to a lower and lower ROI on drug development, making drug development more and more expensive. And that's where we are right now. So it's still going down, and we propose to actually turn that tide by introducing a phenotypic drug discovery, which combines the phenotypic discovery before 85 and the screening capacities after 85. So throughput on phenotypic drug discovery models, when we know that we have lots of compounds already in readily available libraries, and we have lots of technologies that we could put in there. So we propose the disease model-centric era for drug development, bringing human complexity to the root of drug development. We do that in an organ-on-a-chip platform. An organ-on-a-chip is actually nothing different from trying to culture tiny little human tissues with specific functionalities, including parts of disease functionalities, disease aspects, in what we call an organoplate. An organoplate is a microfluidic culture device, and here you're looking at the bottom of an organoplate. The top typically looks like a 384 well plate, and the bottom is made up by, in this case, 40 individually addressable microfluidic channels. And in each of these channels, you can make a little tissue that's made up by three different lanes. So here in the following movie, let me see if the movie wants to run. Maybe somebody can click on it. Yeah, there we go. This is the organoplate. There's the bottom side with the microfluidics. And first what we do is we put a little bit of extracellular matrix in there, which is basically the substrate in which or on which cells will grow. And the extracellular matrix is made liquid, and it's put into the device, and it's steered by the microfluidics into the device. And that's what you see happening right here. Right, the fluid goes in and fills the middle channel of an organoplate. And if you look at it, you dive into it, you see that capillary force pulls it in. There's a microfluidic trick to retain that part of ECM in the middle of the device. And when the ECM is set, we enter culture medium here with cells. These cells start to form a tubule, and this tubule grows against an extracellular matrix. And by tilting the plate every now and then on a specialized device, you get a continuous bidirectional perfusion of medium through these tissues. And in this way, you can set up simple tubular tissues, but also combine it with different cell types in the ECM, and also with a different tubule. So you get two tubules and cells in ECM, which is a fairly complex piece of tissue, actually. We do that in three different types of plates. There's an organoplate two lane, which obviously has two lanes. There's a three lane, which was just in the movie. It has three lanes. And there's a special version of the three lane, which we call the organoplate graft, which has an open well that allows us to put a piece of tissue from the top into the device and let it connect with the vascular bed that grows in the microfluidic device. I will show you some examples of that later. So in the context of tumors, there's many aspects that are important: angiogenesis and vascularization. There's the tumor microenvironment, which is made up by different cell types, an extracellular matrix gel, interstitial flow, and inflammatory processes. We want to analyze these tumors, looking at drug effects, looking at a PDX, for example, to expand the tumor in a mouse, take it out again, and get a bit more volume of tissue. We use organoids, but also look at metastasis. Why does a tumor metastasize? How come that cells get loose and spread to other parts of the body? And finally, a very important topic right now, immuno-oncology, right? Innate immunity, acquired immunity, immune cell recruitment, and immune cell migration are all essential processes in order to get to better treatments of tumors. So first, I'll zoom into a little bit more examples of tumor microenvironment, right? This is an experiment that we did with the MD Anderson Cancer Center. It's in Texas, you probably know it. So our scientists in the US collaborated with them on a prostate cancer project where we do a co-culture of prostate cancer cells, bone stromal cells, as well as human microvascular endothelial cells. So that's a model made up by three different cell types in three different lanes of an organoplate. And we see that these cells very nicely coexist. And when we treat them with a variety of drugs, we can look at the differences in responses of those drugs on this the prostate cancer tissue in a 2D situation, which is a standard way of culturing, and a 3D co-culture situation, which is much more lifelike and like the cells are growing actually inside the tumor. Angiogenesis and vascularization are important parts of how a tumor actually survives and how it can grow or not grow. So first, we can make a vascular bed and induce vascularization in an organoplate in order to make an angiogenesis assay. We do that by seeding a tubule of vascular cells, endothelial cells, in the organoplate and add a mix of angiogenic factors in the adjacent lane of that plate. The cells will start to sprout and form a microvascular bed. And you can look at the extension of the microvascular bed and score many other aspects of that microvascular bed in order to quantify angiogenesis. And here we're looking at just three different combinations of angiogenic factors, all giving different results in angiogenesis of these cells. But more importantly, we can quantify many aspects like the sprout length, the sprout count, the sprout diameter, as well as the sprout shape in these assays in order to quantify how compounds, therapeutic compounds, can interfere with the angiogenic potential of these endothelial vessels. To use angiogenesis and vascularization as a substrate for growing a tumor is, I would say, a revolutionary idea. This could actually replace PDX, so putting tumors into mouse patient-derived xenografts in order to grow the tumor, expand it, and take it out again. And we do that in the organoplate graft. Like I said, the organoplate graft is a three-lane organoplate which has two lanes at the side of an open well. In these two lanes, we seed a tubule, an endothelial tubule, a blood vessel tubule. We induce a vascular bed in the center and then seed a piece of tumor or other tissue, could also be an organoid or a spheroid, onto that vascular bed. And as you see right here, the sprouting starts, then the tissue is added, and the sprouts interact with the tissue and vascularize the tissue. So this is a wonderful methodology to look at the interaction between blood vessels and a tissue that's actually grafted on top of the blood vessels, to look at vascularization, but also study drug delivery into a piece of tissue, or look at immune cell migration and immune cell recruitment in a tumor where the immune cells are actually administered to the tumor through the vascular bed. So here's a few examples of vascularizing organoids, for example. On the left, you see typical setup of a PDX experiment. You transplant a tumor into a mouse, you grow it up and take it out again. Well, we can do that in the organoplate graft on a human vascular bed. So you get a combination of human endothelial cells, human extracellular matrix with a human tumor or piece of tissue grafted on top of it. And this results in wonderful biology, beautiful pictures. Unfortunately, I can't go into the details, but you know, be welcome to take a look at the website of Mimetis, and there you see lots more of these examples. So vascularizing organoids, here we see a combination of a vascular bed and liver organoids, hepatic organoids, and there we see a great interplay between the blood vessels, the vasculature, and the liver cells, where we also have wonderful EM images showing a very intimate contact between the endothelial cells and the hepatocytes, which is very much like the situation in a real liver. So tumor analysis, just a few examples there. Here we look at head and neck squamous cell carcinoma organoids. And this is a collaboration with the Ubrecht Institute where we grew these organoids in an organoplate and exposed them to a number of different therapies in order to look at the response of the tumor to that specific therapy. And we made profiles of individual sets of organoids from individual patients and could actually come up with sensitivity profiles against six different compounds that were administered to these patients. So this is a way to actually start selecting therapies before they're given to a patient in the lab, which is more or less similar to the Agendia situation, where they also try to predict, or actually can predict, the response of a patient's tumor to a therapy before it's given to the patient, which is very important for first preventing adverse side effects, but also to get a better efficacy of the therapy. Here's an example of what we're doing with a company called Pepscope, where we take these 3D tissues and we analyze endogenous kinase activities inside these tissues. This is done by taking the sample from an organoplate. Then there's an entire process which ends up with a targeted LCMS assay to read out the endogenous kinase activity in a piece of tissue that's growing inside an organoplate. Here's an example, in this case, on breast cancer samples. These are fine needle biopsies. What you're looking at is a grid with different kinases profiled across four different patients. I don't want you to go into the details, but the color indicates the level of sensitivity. And to the left, you actually see the pathway coverage of this type of assay. And we're currently employing this on glioblastoma multiformis, or GBM, samples, which we got from the Erasmus Medical Center. And we culture them in organoplates and analyze the kinase activities in these tissues with the Quantikinome assay from Pepscope. Finally, immuno-oncology. So the first thing I'd like to show you is very simple. It's monocyte adhesion and transmigration, how we model that. We make an endothelial tubule, put in there vital dye-stained monocytes, and look at the adhesion of monocytes to the inner wall of that blood vessel when it's challenged with, for example, TNF-alpha in this case. So we can quantify the adhesion of these monocytes very nicely. And here you see that with increasing TNF-alpha concentration, more monocytes adhere to the inner wall of this blood vessel in a microfluidic device. And here's a little movie where you can actually see that it's not just monocytes adhering, but there's one also passing through the wall of the endothelial blood vessel. So it's not just adherence, it's also transmigration that you can assay in this way. A step further, we look at immune cell migration, immune cell recruitment in a similar model. Here we also see an endothelial tubule, which is at the top left picture. We put in vital dye-stained T cells and put in an attractant in the third lane. In this case, that's a pancreatic tumor. And we can measure the number of T cells that move towards the tumor, that are attracted by the tumor. And of course, you can quantify that. It's like a migration assay. At the top, there's no migration. At the bottom, there is migration. This can be fully quantified and used as a screening tool for the migration of T cells through an extracellular matrix in the direction of a tumor. And we've done that with many different circumstances, primed, unprimed cells, and used triggers and leave out the triggers, can all be quantified. So you could look at it as a fax, but then a behavioral fax. It's a migration fax. Here's one of these tubules, just because it looks so beautiful, you can actually dive in, and here you see to the inner wall, the attached T cells, which are stuck to the red endothelial cells. So this is a 3D reconstruction of images that are taken inside the organoplate. And this is a similar setup in a graft plate, where we seeded a piece of tissue in the center, and we administered the T cells through the vascular bed, and you see that the red T cells have actually extravasated and migrated into the tissue, which is seeded in the vascular bed and which is vascularized, which is even a step further in terms of physiological relevance. This is equipment. It comes with the organoplate already. Told you about driving flow through the organoplate. We use a modified rocker, which is called OrganoFlow, and also to measure the integrity, barrier integrity of tubules grown in the organoplate, we had to come up with a good and rapid solution for that, which we called OrganoTear, which allows trans epithelial electrical resistance management measurement on a full plate basis in an organoplate, which tremendously helps to evaluate the endothelial blood vessels, but also kidney tubules and, for example, gut tubules. This is where we are, Mimetas. We have 7 years of pioneering experience in disease modeling. We're a leader in the organ-on-a-chip field, not just because we say, but also market reports say that. We do translational and screenable readouts for drug development. We've proven impact on pharma decision making for a number of our customers and collaborators, currently with about 115 FTEs, 25 papers with businesses in the Netherlands, USA, and Japan. I'd like to thank my colleagues and collaborators for this work, and I'd be happy to answer any of your questions.
Thanks a lot, Jos. It's very interesting, and congratulations on the development of Mimetas. I'm just curious about your business model. Could you elaborate a little bit more on that? Are you just selling the plates, or are you selling a whole service?
Well, we have this wretched hybrid business model, which wasn't allowed about 20 years ago, which is currently looked upon, I think a bit more positively. So we have a product platform, which is the organoplates, with the equipment associated to it. We can even put a tissue in the organoplate and ship it as a product as well. But on top of that, which is actually the first business we did, is to provide this as a service. So with pharma, we started working in 2013 already. The first customer was Galapagos, which was just around the corner, very conveniently. To develop for them models that help them to develop their compounds. And this has grown into a substantial business. But over the last 2 or 3 years, I can say that the sales of the plates through our sales force in worldwide has been catching up very rapidly and is the second pillar of Mimetas.
Yeah, I have another question. You started your presentation with the fact or the trend that the output of the development of new drugs is going down. And I totally agree with that. And could you try to describe what the impact of Mimetas is on that process? I'm aware that Mimetas is not going to solve this worldwide problem. So.
No, absolutely. I think the most important part there is that the assumption that inhibiting a target doesn't mean curing a patient. Why? Because biology is immensely complex. So we understand a lot, and also in the morning we've seen a lot of great understanding how we can actually better predict how drugs are going to work. But at the end of the road, biology is a complex system, which is adaptive, which makes it very, very hard to make good predictions there. So that's where it goes wrong. You find a good biological effect in your simplified model, so inhibiting a target, and at the end of the road, when you start giving it to patients, it fails. I think that phenotypic models are right in the middle there. Because in a phenotypic model, you look at biological behavior. So you're much closer to a real therapeutic effect of a compound rather than, I would say, a more molecular or chemical effect of that compound. That's also true for adverse side effects, because when you test a drug on a piece of tissue, you immediately see if it's cytotoxic, for example. Well, that you would find out in normal preclinical drug development anyway. But the richer information that you can typically get from a phenotypic model will definitely help to get more efficacious compounds first and also safer compounds with less risk of failure down the road. Okay, that's a dream, but I think biologically it makes sense that we just don't understand biology well enough, so let's replicate it and use it to our best benefit.
Thanks a lot. Jos, I hope to meet you soon again.
Thank you very much.
Our third speaker in this block is Sophie Duzoswa. And I'm aware that Jessica Timmermans was announced. They are both from Roche. And due to circumstances, Jessica couldn't join us today. But we are happy that Sophie was able to step in, even on such a short notice. So that's very good. Sophie works at Roche. And she also has a PhD in our field. She has a PhD from the Free University in Amsterdam. And she also has experience abroad because she used to work at Harvard Medical School. And she's a physician by training, and she also has clinical experience in neurosurgery and neuro-oncology. And at this moment, Sophie has a current role as precision medicine partner at Roche. Sophie, the floor is yours.
Thanks for your introduction. Indeed, I did my PhD in the VU Medical Center. I don't actually have the title yet. I still have to defend my thesis, which I hopefully will do early next year. And yes, so I worked in neurosurgery for a little bit and did research on immunotherapy and glioblastoma in the VU Medical Center. And during that time, I just became more and more interested in heterogeneity between patients and personalized healthcare, but also integration of research and care in a more learning system. And that's how I really got inspired, actually, by how Roche is really putting this on the agenda. And so this summer, I made the transfer. And I really hope for better cooperation between academia and pharma and biotech, because I think that would really accelerate our transition towards personalized healthcare. So Roche is a pharma company, and I think Roche is in a very good position to actually accelerate that transition with under one roof both diagnostics and pharma, but also bioinformatics in Flatiron Healthcare and also Foundation Medicine. So, I will tell you something more about how we contribute to personalizing healthcare. In the Netherlands, the Personalized Healthcare Catalyst Alliance, in collaboration with Gupta, analyzed basically the status of precision medicine both in the 90s and today. And as you can see in this graph, we made pretty good progress. And during the same time, also burden of disease lowered and quality of care improved. So working towards the right treatment for the right patient at the right time, as mentioned before, really improves quality of care. And at the same time, while reducing over-treatment, also is good for our health economic side of the story. So basically, they also predicted that if we would implement all the technology and innovations that are actually already there or almost there, then we could really improve still in the Netherlands. So we could actually add 2 to 4 extra weeks in good health for a Dutch person each year, or up to 3 to 7 extra years, healthy years in a lifetime. So that's quite a bit. And what's in our way? We think mostly implementation. So in Roche, so I'm sorry, this slide is actually in Dutch. But in Roche, the Netherlands, we really discuss a lot about how we envision the future of our healthcare system. And this is a drawing of us discussing how we would like it to be. And then it's always about we would love to have good quality and reimbursed diagnostics for every patient. And in oncology, we mean broad genomic profiling panels. And then we not only want to be for every patient to be able to get these tests and avoid the postal code medicine, as was mentioned before, but we also want to learn from it. So we want to save the data, and we want to apply all this knowledge in our development and also in our decision process for choosing the best treatments for the patient in front of the doctor in care. And so we really need to create this learning healthcare system using the data that we collect. And eventually we will also want to use this data to go more into value-based payment. So to show you an example, in our current system, if you imagine this patient with a lung tumor, then with standard chemotherapy, her chance of responding is probably around 30%. And her predicted survival will be around about a year. If we look more into the biology of her tumor, and for example, we find that she has an ALK mutation, which is present in 5% of non-small cell lung cancer patients, then she could get an ALK inhibitor, and her chance of responding could go up to 80%, and her chance her median survival could, or her predicted survival could go up to 5 years. But if you now imagine that this tumor is not in the lung of this patient, but a couple of centimeters to the front, in the breast of this patient, and we also find that she has an ALK mutation, then this is a very difficult situation in the current system in the Netherlands, because usually patients with breast cancer are not tested for ALK mutations. And if we do test them, and we find an ALK mutation, we actually don't know whether or what would be her response to an ALK inhibitor. We simply don't have the data. And if we want to try to give her a treatment specific for the biology of her tumor, an ALK inhibitor, then in the Dutch system, that's not reimbursed. And even if it would if we would be able to treat her, then we're not really storing the data, and we're not learning from the case. So we really think that we should look at oncology more in a more tumor agnostic way. So from tumor type to tumor biology. Ever since doctors discovered tumors, we name them after the organ in which the tumor is found. And so we're still talking about brain cancer, lung cancer, breast cancer. But we now know that cancer is not a disease of an organ, it's a disease of the genome. And we see huge variability within these patient groups. And one patient might respond to a treatment, whether another doesn't respond or even have side effects. And that's why we think we should really stratify patients more based on genomics than on the organ of origin. And we called it this tumor agnostic. So also the FDA and the EMA is predicted to register tumor agnostic treatments more and more and more in the coming years. So that's really good news. But the problem is that we need to find these patients. because we really already got to the low-hanging fruit now. So, for example, the EGFR and ELK and BRAF. But most of these treatments that we will come up with in the future, not only Roche, but also other pharma companies, will be targeting genomic alterations that might be have a very low incidence. So one example is NTRK, for example, NTRK rearrangements. We see them in 0.2 to 0.4% of solid tumors. You can imagine it's really hard to find these patients. And so, for example, in the Netherlands, if we need to screen 25,000 patients to actually find the 70 to 75 patients with NTRK gene fusions that we have in the Netherlands. And at the moment, we have quite some trouble filling up a study. So we, for example, identified 6 patients in the last couple of years, which really indicates that we're underperforming in terms of diagnostics, which also has luckily got some attention today. So this is why Roche really collaborates and works with, or acquired actually even, Foundation Medicine. And this is a company that has genomic profiling services. So how this works is you send a piece of tissue or a tube of blood to the lab of Foundation Medicine, and for Europe that's in Germany. And then they sequence the tumor DNA and really look into a very large set of genes. So it's not really hotspot testing, it's not really whole genome testing. We really look very focused on 324 alterations that we know are actionable now or in the near future. And the physician gets back a report with all the alterations, the possible treatments, and also possible clinical trials that could be matched to this patient. And this is really specific for the US or the EU, so depending on the also EMA registrations. And this is a test that is certified IVDR, and it has a CE certification, both as a diagnostic but also as a clinical decision support. And we really think that there is a good place for tests like this test to really meet the demands for testing. Because if hopefully in the near future we get reimbursement for broad genomic profiling in the Netherlands, we really think that we need to scale up the testing capacity to actually be able to give all patients that deserve a test one of these tests. So what we do think is very important is not only testing, but also looking at data. And of course, data from clinical trials is very well registered and is very well accessible. But in this slide, the clinical trial data is represented by the small dot. And as you probably also know, the majority of the patients are not in trials. Actually, the patients in trials represent 4 or 5% of all patients, so 95 to 96% are not registered, their data is not registered. So we really think there is a large gap and a large opportunity also to really learn more from the data. That's why we work also with Flatiron Health. And this is a data company which has set up a data infrastructure and collects clinical data from oncology patients all over the US. And they collected data, clinical outcome data, from over 2.5 million patients from 2,500 clinics in the US. And this data is anonymized and shared for research and regulatory purposes. So this is really a way in which we can accelerate innovation and also accelerate the regulatory access process for new drugs. So, and the beauty of this is that we also now have a database that is actually shared. So we have a clinical genomic database with patients that are both in the Foundation Medicine database and in the Flatiron database. And last year, it was about 45 patients, and we expect it to double every year. And this is a data set in which we can really learn from the genomic alterations that we see and the treatments that patients get in a longitudinal way. And also this will greatly, or and is already greatly contributing to our research and development. So really, we're working with a continuous learning system where we collect a lot of data, use machine learning and artificial intelligence to analyze this data, which contributes to faster R&D and also improved patient outcomes. And I think one very important aspect not to forget in all this is that by collecting so much data and accelerating all this, we create so much data, both genomic data, but also other diagnostics, clinical data. And thank you. I hope you still heard me. but we think that this is increasing so much that we really need to also think about clinical decision support systems, because this is not something that individual doctors can actually keep up with. So all the sources of data, from patient characteristics to imaging, molecular pathology data, and also, for example, data from wearables in the near future, we should actually use that to develop clinical decision supports and improve care for patients. So changing a system is not something to do on your own. There are many stakeholders in the Netherlands, and we really think that we need to co-create and collaborate. So we like to say, let's make this personal together. And thank you for your attention.
Thanks a lot, Sophie, for this overview. And I think you're right. It's a big change, and we have to over, and we can only manage it together. What I was thinking, because Roche already has a whole line in this pipeline, things you need, is Roche also planning to acquire or to develop a clinical support company, or do you already have something in your portfolio?
If you look at what Foundation Medicine is offering at the moment, it's really a diagnostic tool, of course, and it has a diagnostic certification, but it's also certified as a clinical decision support tool. So it really provides information about the aberrations, the genomic aberrations in this certain patient with the matched treatments and also clinical trial possibilities, with a lot of information about these specific targets. So that already is a kind of a clinical decision support tool, I think. To be honest, in the near future, tools coming up, I'm not sure. Yeah, mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure that they will, but it's I can't really give an example now.
I also have a question from the audience. I didn't read it by myself yet, but the question is, does Roche or Foundation Medicine collaborate with academia to systematically understand the functionality of the alterations?
So, yes, this data is accessible. Not freely. There is this functionality that's called Foundation Insights. And this is a way for Roche and Foundation Medicine to actually collaborate with researchers that really want to look into research questions using this data. And so this is really the data, the combined data with Foundation Medicine and Flatiron Health.
I noticed that Flatiron was a preliminary active in the United States. Or did I miss anything?
Yeah, so that's really a US thing. And we are really keen on discussing and collaborating on creating something like this in the Netherlands as well, because we really think, for example, testing is very important for the patients today to actually identify the druggable targets. But the reason why we think broad testing is very important is that we also need to collect information about targets that we might not test yet, but we need that information also for the future drugs in the pipeline that will come up and as a sort of historical control.
Yes. It's sad, and I think it's true that the data is the new gold. Who do you think should own the data?
I think there are multiple possibilities. It could be really centralized. It could also be controlled in a more federated system. I think it would be beautiful if eventually every person owns his or her own data and can choose who to share it with. So I think eventually that would be ideal, but it's also not the most easy way. So maybe a centralized system could be a step towards an eventual federated system. Yes.
I agree. That would be a nice future thing. Sophie, thanks again for your insightful talk.
And thank you.
Hope to see you soon again. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we move on to the last speaker of today. I think we have seen many different talks in this part from a lot of companies, big companies, small companies, and the next speaker will tell us more about a new established organization in the Netherlands. They were launched at the beginning of this year, and the name is Health Innovation. And I just checked with the speaker, and she would describe it as an infrastructure initiative. Our next speaker is Maruska Rovers. Welcome, Maruska. She's a professor at Radboud University, but today she's here as the director of Health Innovation. Maruska, the floor is yours.
Thank you. And thanks for being here. So indeed, this session was about implementation, so I'd like to tell a bit more about our infrastructure, Health Innovation Netherlands, also called HNL. And together with Karl Moons, I'm one of the two ambassadors. But it's the infrastructure established by the Ministry of Health, but we have all relevant parties in the Netherlands involved, and I will come back to that. But I also would like to thank the organizers today, Holland Bio and Oncode, because I really think the way out of this crisis or this pandemic is innovation. And we can say it's out of the pandemic, so we need innovations for COVID, but I also think that we've seen that there's a high pressure on our healthcare system. So we also need to innovate in cancer treatments and all other treatments to keep the pressure down. I also have a few poll questions because I'm the last speaker of today, so I have three poll questions. I hope to make it a bit interactive. But the poll questions are left, or I should go back maybe. Yeah, so the first question is, what percentage of all new treatments, and that's everything, so that's not only cancer treatments, not only pharmaceuticals, but it's also new devices or even behavioral treatments, is better than the alternative? Not so many votes anymore, maybe people have to install again. Ooh. Quite a dispersed view. Maybe it's going towards 50% and 30%, I see most votes, although there are people saying 100% and 90% as well. Indeed, there is a huge Cochrane review which compared all new treatments with the best alternative or a placebo, and they show that only 50% of all new treatments is better than the alternative or the placebo. And if you really looked at clinically relevant data, then it was only 30%. And that's why we need a new infrastructure, I think, that we indeed help people to implement their innovations. So the next question will come up, I think. Yeah, it's how many of all medic interventions do enter the market with CE or after CE? So how many do get past the CE or in the next future, the IVDR? Also quite dispersed, I see. It moves to 20-40%, I see. And indeed, only 20% reaches the CE. So it's from idea, so of course a lot of ideas do not go any further, but from idea to after CE, 80% disappears before CE. And that's the bumpy ride you see over here. So what you see on this slide is the way from idea to the end product, reimbursement and implementations from bench to bedside or from idea to bedside. And really, is we call it a roller coaster. And many innovators only think about the next step. And what we're trying to do with HNL is to start from the beginning and try to discuss the whole pathway and speed it up. So as I said, many do not pass CE, but also those that do pass CE, of the 20% that do pass, 70% disappears within 2 years from the market, either because the product did not have added value, or it was difficult to implement, or if it was a device, a newer device was already there because it took so long to get CE. And this is problematic for everyone. I think you will all agree with me on that. It's problematic for innovators and investors because we spend a lot of money, research and development money, on products that will never reach the market, which we could have spent otherwise if we would have steered it earlier in another way. It's problematic for patients, which probably is most important, because some of the products that might be very valuable for them will never enter the market, whereas other products that might not be so valuable for them or have no added value do enter the market. And it's problematic for the healthcare system and the society as a whole, because we spend a lot of money which we could have spent differently. And of course, the challenge is, can we know upfront how to spend the right money? That's at least what we're aiming at. So we have a new approach. We want to speed up from idea to implementation and to help innovators to see whether indeed have a right idea and everybody involved is enthusiastic about it. So that's our mission. Our mission is to stimulate the development and implementation of safe, valuable, affordable healthcare innovations. And we mainly focus on medical devices and in vitro diagnosis, so MDR, IVDR, and now CE is only more or less about safety, but that will change as from May next year. Then you also have to prove effectiveness, although it's not clearly defined what they mean by effectiveness, so we also have to find out that in the coming years. So it will be a challenge, it will even be more challenging than it already was. So we think that's also the momentum why HNL is so important. There are also important differences, because a lot of things in the cancer world are about pharmaceutics, although the biomarkers and the diagnostic tests are increasing tremendously. But here you see the main differences between the medical devices and the pharmaceuticals. So there's a difference in research and development. It's more than 15 years, we know, from research and development for pharmaceuticals, where it's about 5 years, slightly longer, for medical devices. But also, the life cycle of the product differs. So where a medicine, a pharmaceutical, might be there for 20 years, a device is there mostly for about 2.5 years. Then there is a new device or a new prototype or a new development going on. Procedures for entering the market, EMA for pharmaceuticals, for devices, and later on in vitro diagnostics, so the biomarkers, will have to go through the notified bodies who do the CE and IVDR approval. And that's arranged country by country. So we have a new European regulation, but the notified bodies are organized per European country and not like the EMA more centrally. Most pharmaceutical companies are the larger companies. They survived with those long life cycles of both the research and development and the products. Whereas in what we see, medical device and biomarkers is a new field. A lot of small and medium enterprises, startups, young people who really want to add something. And reimbursement is different, so you have to make a pharmaceutical dossier for a pharmaceutical. And many of the reimbursement for medical devices are a state of science and practice in the Netherlands, or you have to see whether you can get it reimbursed under a current DBC, so a diagnostic treatment combination. So what do we offer as HNL? We have three products. It's an innovation guide, innovation roadmap, and an implementation guide. And we have a network for clinical studies. So we have all UMCs connected, like Oncode has, but also the local hospitals are willing to help with doing the clinical studies, which are necessary for the new regulation. And our main product at the moment is that we organize roundtables. And here you see what a round table is, more or less. So we have a chair and a case lead who prepare the round table. And depending on the innovator who's asking us for help, and that can be a question related, what should I do to get CE? Or what should I do to get to be implemented or to go indeed after CE, be reimbursed, for example. But so far we had many before CE, and then we have a CE expert to help what was needed to get CE. We have a product specialist, can be someone from another company. We have a patient representative, so we have an official agreement with the Dutch patient organization. We'll deliver one or two patients, discuss at the table what's important for them. Clinical epidemiologists, medical specialists, so we also have a collaboration with the Dutch Federation of Medical Specialists, who deliver one or two, sometimes three, because mostly it's a multifactorial disease. So we have the relevant specialists at the table on behalf of the organization. We have a relevant policymaker, an HTA expert, someone from the Dutch Healthcare Authority, it has to do with reimbursement, a healthcare insurer, and a healthcare institute. And I think nobody so far has reached this. So we have all relevant parties at the table for half a day, for about 3 hours. And that's what we have to offer. And of course, you can go by them one by one. I know many companies have to go this route, but then you have to go one by one to these stakeholders. And we have them at the table, and they cannot pinpoint at each other, because if someone says something, the other one will respond. So that is what also brings a round table. How does it work? What's the setup of a round table? We do some desk research. So one of the UMC is mostly the case lead, has a dedicated person who contacts the innovator, the innovator contacts the case lead. We look at the claims, what they want to know, what are the questions they want answered, and then the case lead starts studying both the literature, might have some interviews with experts in the field, in their own academic center, also look at the gray literature, Google searches about maybe concurrent techniques or concurrent biomarkers, whether it's FDA approval for a similar sort of biomarker, for example. Then we have the round table, where first the innovator provides a pitch, gives a pitch about his product. Then the case lead presents what we found during our research and what the claims were and what the evidence is for each of the claims, or whether there is a lack of evidence. Then we have a round of questions with the innovator there. And then the innovator leaves the room, and then the other parties start discussing the claims and what to do indeed to get either CE or to get implemented in practice. So all parties discuss whether they also what they think of the innovation. So you also get a feeling whether everybody's enthusiastic or maybe half or nobody. And we are honest about that. That might be the risk, but if everybody's enthusiastic, that's of course also then everybody wants to help you to get your product really to the bedside. And after that, we write an innovation guide with the steps. So not only the first step, if the first step would be CE, we would say, what should you do for CE or IVDR? And then we will discuss also the subsequent steps. So if we see a hurdle or barrier for implementation, we immediately say so. So these are the people you have to convince, because there might be some problems, maybe in the working progress that has to differ due to the new product, for example. So here is one of the CEOs of a company saying it would have saved us a lot of time, money, and many discussions. And that's what we see. So not only all people, all stakeholders at the table are very enthusiastic, because they see the new products and see what's happening within the stakeholders, but all innovators so far were also very enthusiastic about the table. They all said things like this. It really helps us. We get 5 years in one morning or one afternoon. So, as said, we have been launched by the minister in January, and so far also partly related to COVID, but we have done 8 round tables over the last year. 4 are really technical medical devices. We did 3 biomarkers and 1 other test. Many of the products were before CE, before IVDR, and of course the IVDR only starts in 2022. So we also advise to try to get CE as soon as possible, because then you have some time left for the next round. And we try also to give advice how to do so. So we discussed the potential barriers, as I said, both before how to get CE and after CE. And we also link the innovator to our network if needed. So if they want to do a next study, and partly the small and medium enterprises do often not know how to enter the academic of the university medical centers or the hospitals. So we also, if we really believe in the innovation, we try to link them with an academic organization or a local hospital to try to get access to the medical field. So a concrete case might be the best example. It's a biomarker for a cancer. I cannot disclose the complete company and did not ask for permission, but also not sure whether they are willing so, but it was not CE approved yet, also not FDA approved. Sometimes you see that. All experts were very enthusiastic about this test because there was a test what was a substitute, or could be a substitute for another much more expensive and invasive test, but also could test slightly broader than the current test. Well, all experts proposed very concrete follow-up studies. The first was how to get CE, and also we had some concrete examples, or maybe similar within the FDA, to get FDA approval as soon as possible. And CE as well, so that then the company had some more time to do the rest for the next, the new MDR, IVDR. And we also had a concrete portfolio of subsequent clinical studies. So how to prove the clinical effectiveness for the new IVDR. And we linked this company indeed to an academic center to do these future studies and to get access to the clinical data. And what we learned, and might be important for many of you, is that a lot of companies look at the healthcare insurance or the healthcare institute for reimbursement. But many of those biomarkers will fall under the current diagnostic treatment combination. So that means you have to convince the medical specialist, the doctors, and they have to convince together with the company, the board of directors of the hospital, because then it can be reimbursed in the already existing diagnostic treatment combination. And we are an official hub of Excite International, and Excite International is a similar initiative as HINL, but this one is based in Northern America, Canada and North America, and they have the FDA, Kaiser Permanente, Blue Cross, several large American institutes where they do the studies with. And our American companies, they might want to get access to Europe, so they are referred to us, and we can refer companies to Excite, and they can discuss with the FDA and parties, relevant stakeholders over there. And we will organize a conference in June next year together with Excite International to indeed see whether we can also do studies together so we can directly get FDA and CE approval or IVDR approval at once with the same study. So you can contact us. Here you see some information. We also have a LinkedIn page where you can follow us and our activities. So feel free to contact us also for some advice. We're happy to answer your questions. And here you see all contributors so far. So we really have all relevant stakeholders in the Netherlands, both public and private, combined in this initiative. Thank you for your attention.
Maruska, congratulations initiating this initiative and also launching it this year, and already have done 8 roundtables. So I think it's a great start for the first year. I was wondering, because you mentioned, so of course, several times the FDA, and you also pointed out that the EMA does not have that similar role in Europe, if you're talking about medical devices. And we work with the notified bodies. What's your opinion about that? Should the EMA take up a similar role as the FDA, or shouldn't we change anything?
I'm not sure that everybody agrees with me, but we actually would not like the EMA to have an exactly similar role, maybe as the FDA, but not a similar role as for pharmaceuticals. We know all how strict that is. And if we talk about medical devices, biomarkers, there might also be e-health. So if it's an implantable device, we want to see a randomized controlled trial. I think we all want that. But if it's e-health, there might be other study designs, so it might actually be better. So we actually hope that by doing this together with also the FDA through Excite, we can also show the notified bodies and the European Commission that we might need other alternatives to speed up the process a bit.
Yeah, there was also a question about approval. New medical diagnostic device, like an organoplate, was the example, is allowed on the market, is it only tested on clinical effectiveness or safety as well?
So at this moment, if you have a CE, you only need CE approval, also for everything that's under and then it's mainly safety. They say so, but it's not, it's safety. And then we have, of course, the implant files with all disasters. That's why they changed the regulation. Mm-hmm. But as from next year, the new medical device regulation will be in place in May, and then May the year after, 2022, we also have the in vitro diagnostic. And then it's explicitly stated that you have to prove effectiveness, but it didn't define effectiveness very clearly yet.
That's quite alarming, and that reminds me of the moving goals Caroline showed us. Is that the case?
Yeah, so what you see now is that many companies go to FDA first, and that's more or less what Caroline said before as well. Let's follow the FDA, and what we see is the companies move to the US, and I think that's indeed threatening, particularly for our patients that want those innovations. And that's why we also started INL, also to create awareness, because if this happens, we will see it. Hopefully, but I assume we at least can show some examples, and then we can bring it back to Brussels, hopefully.
So when do you expect any clarity about effectiveness?
Effectiveness of, to show?
For the regulation, the definition.
Yeah, we will see what happened after May and what indeed they define, we'll see what they want to see for effectiveness.
So we have to wait now?
Yeah, I think even the notified bodies are not sure, so they also... Yeah, at least if you ask them, they also, for something, for implantables, it's quite clear. We want randomized trials. But particularly for e-health and software will also fall under the new MDR. How to test that? When is it effective? It's a challenge. Okay.
Yeah, it's absolutely a challenge. And I think it also only points out the importance of an initiative like health innovation. Thanks again.
Thank you.
So that brings us at the end of the program of this event today. Talking for myself, I learned a lot of new diagnoses, new ways to measure things. And I already had the idea that these testing strategies can really help us. It can help us for drug development, which we have to do faster and better. And it can also help to improve the outcomes for patients. I'm also quite optimistic. All the developments I saw today, I think there is a bright future for guiding cancer treatments. So I would like to ask everybody of you, keep up the good work and hang on there. We will meet in person next year. Thank you for watching.